Let your mind just be on him right now. Worship him from your spirit.
Hallelujah.
Worship him from your soul. Worship him from your body. We're lifting ourselves up to him. Just see your whole, your soul lifted up to him. Just see your soul lifted up. Hallelujah. Lift our souls up to him so that his presence and the union will just be manifested in us. The power of God manifested in us. Expectation, expecting higher and greater things.
Hallelujah.
Lift your soul up to the Lord this morning. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, just hallelujah.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Hallelujah.
Oh my soul.
Hallelujah.
Worship is
holy. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Yes, hallelujah.
Sing like never before. Oh my soul. Worship your holy.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
to lift your souls up to the Lord this morning. Lift your soul up to the Lord.
Ourselves to you, Lord Jesus. We bind ourselves to you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Satan, you have no place. You have no victory. We're more than conquerors. We're overcomers. In Christ Jesus, who are mine and gone. We're overcomers in every area of our life. Thank you, Jesus. I'm an overcomer.
I'm not gonna die.
In the name of Jesus. hear the Lord speaking now? Do you hear the Spirit of the Lord speaking in your heart right now? You ought to hear him right now talking to you. You ought to hear God speaking in your spirit right now. Hallelujah. You ought to hear him saying something like, it's all right. 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 You ought to hear him saying things like, don't worry. Stop worrying. Stop worrying. It's all right. It's all right. Hallelujah. Think above. Think above. He said, stop thinking below. Think above. Think above. Take your thoughts higher. Take them higher. Take them higher. You're thinking too low. You're thinking too small. Take them higher. Take your thoughts higher. Take your thoughts higher. Think about what you're thinking now. Think about. Think about. Think about.
Hallelujah.
I possess the power. it's all right. Tell him it's all right because you possess it. Grab that person's hand next to you. Say, I'm touching you with the hand of Christ. Because Christ is in my body. So I'm touching you with the hand of Christ. Glory, hallelujah. Say, I'm blessing you right now. I'm blessing you. You really are blessing that person. Because you're touching them with the hand of Christ. You ought to go ahead and bless them. You ought to go ahead and pray for them right there. You ought to go ahead and bless them right there. In the name of Jesus. You ought to bless them right now with that hand that you're touching. You ought to touch them and you ought to begin to bless them. Hallelujah. Bless them. Bless them. Bless them. Hallelujah. You ought to touch them and bless them in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Don't look at your performance. Don't think about your performance. Think about Jesus' performance. Don't think about what you did last night. Think about what Jesus has done. And bless him with the hand of Jesus. Bless him with the hand of Jesus. Hallelujah. I bless you. Bless you. Bless your body. Bless you. The health of your life. And bless your mind. Hallelujah. I bless you. I bless you. Hallelujah. 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 Bless them, bless them, bless them in the name of Jesus. I bless you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you for loving me.
Thank you for loving me.
I love you.
And it's not that God was wrong with the first thing he gave me. It's just that when you are willing to go further and higher, when you're willing to go deeper, swim out a little further, and God will let you go. He'll say, oh, you ready to go a little further? When you started this, you wasn't ready to go this far. Oh, I didn't know you was ready to go this far, but you're ready to go a little further, so let's go a little further. Let's go a little deeper, go a little higher. Amen.
Amen.
And so God began to work in my spirit on last night. Began to show me some things that if we're not careful as believers, we'll miss it. It's so connected with doing church and church programs. And you fall into the same rut that most churches and believers, Christians have fell into. But we just believe salvation is to keep us out of hell. That our life is just to be prepared to go to heaven. You know, when we were little kids, salvation only meant to us not going to hell. We just was trying to keep out of hell, that's all. You gave your life to Jesus. You gave your life to Jesus because you simply just didn't want to burn. You ain't know nothing about the Holy Ghost. You didn't know nothing about the power. You knew nothing about greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. All you knew is you had got your ticket to go to heaven. and had fear and possibly missed hell. Amen. The other stuff was, the knowledge started to come a little later. But we accepted Jesus for the mere fact we just didn't want to go to hell. Amen. We still don't want to go to hell. Amen.
Amen.
But that's not what we present, or that's not what we throw out there first. Amen. We talk about salvation and being redeemed and being Christ-like and being children of the living God. And we've grown a little bit now. And we've matured a lot in that we know that our walk with God is not a superficial walk. It can be for some believers. And that our call to Christianity is not a call to be weak. We were weak before we came. There's no reason for us to be weak after coming. We were powerless before we came. There's no reason for us to be powerless after we've come to Jesus. Amen. We walked in darkness before we came. There's no reason for us to continue to walk in darkness. We walked in fear before we came. There's no reason for us to continue to walk in fear. We were ignorant before we came. There's no reason for us to remain ignorant. Amen. We was led by our flesh, by our body before we came. There's no reason for us to continue to be led by our body, by our flesh. Amen?
Amen.
So when we talk about the spirit and the soul and the body, God has given us some awesome lessons. We know that our spirit is connected to God. That if you are not connected to God, if you haven't received Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, if you've not received Jesus in your heart, then we know that we are spiritually dead. I don't care how much physically alive you are spiritually dead.
Amen.
You are spiritually dead if you have not received Jesus Christ in your spirit. In 1 Thessalonians 5:23, which is our foundation, it says that God wants our whole man, our spirit, our soul, and our body. He wants it sanctified, holy. He wants it to be made whole, which means he wants Christ to be in your spirit, Christ to be in your soul, and Christ to be in your body.
Amen.
That Christ has to be present in all three areas, your spirit, your soul, and your body. And he has to be present in that particular order. That before salvation, we were spiritually dead. We were born in sin, which means our spirit was dead. We had no spirit. God is the only one that can possess your spirit. We said that. The devil cannot possess your spirit. Only God can possess your spirit. And so as long as God can possess your spirit, if you haven't received Jesus as your Lord, you are spiritually dead. After receiving Jesus as your Lord, you are spiritually alive, meaning now you are in contact with God. Before, you were not in contact with God. You were simply living according to your soul, which is your mind and your emotions and your feelings. You were doing things based on your intellect, based on your knowledge, based on what you read, what somebody told you, what you believed. You were simply living off of your soul life. Your soul life was directing your body. Your body is connected to the world. Your soul is connected to intellect. Your spirit is connected to God. When you're made spiritually alive, your soul, your spirit is connected to God. Your soul is in a position where it can be renewed. The Bible says not to be conformed to the world, but to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now you're in a position where your mind can be renewed from your spirit because it's in contact with God. And so we said the devil cannot possess your spirit, but the devil can possess your soul. And that's what he does. He possesses the soul of man. He possesses your mind. He inhabits your mind. He lives and dwells in your mind. Amen. He lives and dwells in your mind. He dictates thoughts in your mind, imaginations in your mind. thoughts and imagination that the Bible tells us to cast down thoughts, to cast down imaginations that exalt themselves against the knowledge of God. When the devil tells you you're going to die, that's a thought. When God has already said you're going to live and not die. When the devil said you can't do it, that's a thought. Amen. When God said you can do all things through Christ that strengthens you. So we are told to cast down thoughts and imaginations that exalt themselves against the knowledge of God. But we've come to realize that because the devil cannot possess my spirit, because God does not allow anyone in that spirit. He says, I am spirit and I come to you in spirit and in truth. And which means he is not allowing anything to possess your spirit. As believers, we've often thought that our spirits are possessed with evil spirits, but our mind is possessed with evil spirits. It's your mind that's possessed with the evilness of the devil. It's your mind that's possessed with the wickedness of the devil. And that's a good thing because we can cast that down. We can cast it down. You can't get in my spirit, devil. I'm a believer. Maybe I'm not living righteous or living holy, but I still got help because as long as I'm connected to God, I can begin to hear from God and I can evict the devil out of my mind. I can cause the devil to be removed from my mind, which is my soul. Amen. He wants my soul so bad. He wants your soul so bad because if he's got your soul, he's got your life. Your soul is nothing but your life. Your soul is where you just kind of process everything, where you're programmed. And we were programmed from Adam to be like we are. We were programmed to be corrupted. We were programmed to live in sin. We were all born in sin. But Jesus has come and our spirit has been made alive so that we can be reprogrammed. And we are reprogrammed by the renewing of our mind. Amen. And so I want to move on to the body today, to talk about the body. But the Lord don't like us talking about the body too much because it gives too much credit to the appetite of the world. We all know about sin, amen, and we know that the body is connected to sin, and it's connected to the world, it's connected to those things that are sins, and sins are not what you say they are, sins are what God say they are. And so your body is connected to the sin of the world. But your body can be renewed and can be made whole according to 1 Thessalonians 5:23. It can be made renewed. It can be renewed and it can be made whole simply by your spirit, amen, causing your mind, your soul, and your body to be renewed. Not conformed, but transformed. Say transformed.
Transform.
Come on, say I need to be transformed.
I
tell you, I believe in God that we transform before we leave here today. Amen. I'm gonna say it again. I'm believing that you may not be able to see it, but I'm asking you to believe with me that God will transform you before you leave here today. Amen. Come on, give God a praise and shout. Amen. 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 You know the thing about being transformed from being programmed in the old way to being reprogrammed is so deceptive that you don't even know you need to be reprogrammed.
Amen.
The mind is so deceiving that you think you got it all together. Because the mind is connected to the things of this world. It's connected to the intellect. It's connected to your knowledge and what you know. And if you're one of them individuals that think you know a lot, you jacked up from the forest. You really messed up because you don't realize that your mind is leading you. And your mind is the only piece, a part of you, that can be possessed, oppressed by the devil. Amen. Well, I'll tell you what, we're serving an eviction notice to the devil this morning. Hallelujah. We say it from our mouth and we clap our hands, but I want you to clap your soul this morning. Your soul got to get in on the clap and on the pep rap. Your soul got to get excited. Your soul got to get excited about the devil no longer running your life, running you down. Disturbing you, distracting you, discouraging you. The devil, amen, is doing all these things. Amen. He attacking people. He attacking people in our church. in this ministry because he's attacking people in their minds.
Amen.
And if you ain't careful, you'll look at the person and not the devil. You'll look at the person and not the attack. And the devil's saying, if I can just trick them. See, he tricked a lot of parents. They're going to put the kids out on me. You know, got on drugs, got addicted to something. They got messed up on something because we didn't raise them right. And then when we raised them, we didn't pray for them like we should have. We didn't cover them. We raised them. We took them to church. But we really didn't help them establish a personal relationship with Jesus. And so we've kind of wrote them off and said, you know, I'll just turn you over to a reprobate mind, you know, like we got the ability to do that as believers, amen. God never gave us that assignment, amen. But we have turned people over, amen, because we've gotten tired and because we don't know how to help them. We've gotten to the church, gotten where we don't know how to help people. So when we don't know how to help people, we just put them out. When we don't know how to help them, we just say, well, you know, it's something else. We turn to the mindset of the world. I'm guilty.
Yes, sir.
As a pastor.
Yes.
I'm guilty. And that's what the Lord dealt with me with last night.
Amen.
He dealt with me.
Yes,
the church is a hospital.
That's right.
Everybody here was sick at one time. And came here sick. And got healed. People might not knew you when you were sick, but you knew you when you were sick. You knew you when you was messed up. You knew yourself when your mind was messed up. When you was living all kind of ways and doing all kind of things. Amen? Amen? If I told Dre right now, put your DVD in. Let us rewind it. Some of us would be tipping out. I know God brought me from the Lord. Anybody know that? Don't get so saved you don't remember where you come from. Don't get so saved you don't remember how you used to cuss. That was a spirit. I know I had a spirit of cussing. I ain't never been in a lady, but I could cuss like a sailor.
Yes,
amen. And some of y'all knew me, know what I'm talking about.
Woo.
Amen. Woo. But it's a spirit. Had a spirit of lust.
Yes.
Sure was in me. I had a spirit of lust. And the only reason I can tell you that because I'm saved now.
Amen.
You know when you're saved because you don't care about how people look at you.
Amen.
You don't care about what people think about you, amen? You thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. The church, say the church.
Church.
Supposed to be able to deal with everything.
Amen.
I said the church is supposed to be able to deal with everything. Everything. We the body of believers. We Christ-like. Amen. We heirs to the promises of God. What is it we can't deal with? Who we gonna let come in our house? In your personal house? You gonna let somebody come in your house and do what they wanna do? Act like they wanna act? No. Not in my house. Amen. No, and I don't have to call nobody to help me get them out. I can get them out of there. Because I don't already read scenarios in my mind. If this happened, I'm going to do this. If that happened, I'm going to do that. Y'all get in the closet. Let me do what I got to do.
Yes,
amen. Because you plan for stuff like that. As believers, we got to plan. We got to plan. We got to prepare ourselves. We in warfare. Amen. And the church is a hospital. Jesus said the well need not a physician. Amen. So, I want to talk today about our soul. Talked about our soul the last time. We moved to our body, but God said, now it's time for the soul to be lifted up and to be connected to Him. See, it's already there. It's already in place. God has already put in place from the Spirit that our spirit will renew our mind, that our spirit will transform our mind. so that our spirit and our soul, that our spirit, will, our soul, which is our mind, would be elevated together. And that we will be able to do exactly what God has done, what Jesus has done. Every believer in here is supposed to be able to do everything that Jesus has done. When we look at ourselves and we say, why is it not happening? It ain't because of Jesus, and it ain't because of God, and it's not because of his word. It's because of us. Amen. Amen. That's good news. That's good news. It's good news to know it ain't God that's holding back. That's good news. If it was God that's holding back, we have nowhere to go. It's not God, it's us. We have to see ourselves as Jesus saw himself with God. I gotta see myself like Jesus saw himself. You gotta see yourself like Jesus saw himself with God. Amen.
Amen.
Come on, go to my next one here, sister. We're gonna move fast now. I can't look down. Y'all gotta look at me. For I am not ashamed. Say, I'm not ashamed.
I'm not ashamed.
Of the gospel of Christ. Come on now. What is the gospel? The power, man. Glory! We gotta stop being afraid of the gospel.
Amen.
Amen. And we can't get cold on this thing, man.
Amen.
We can't get cold on. We gotta stay burning hot. Not a for shame of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it's what? It is the power. It is the power. Say power. God said it like it's power. Say power. It's the power. It is the power. It is the power. What we learn in this church is what we're going to mimic at home. What we do in this ministry is what we're going to do at home. If we cast out in this church, we're going to cast out at home. If we deliver in this church, we're going to deliver at home. If we heal in this church, we're going to heal at home. If we stand in this church, we're going to stand at home. If we shrink back in this church, we're going to shrink back at home.
Amen.
Amen. Our soul, say our soul. Man, my soul, your soul got to be lifted up. Our souls have got to be lifted up. Our souls have got to be lifted up because our souls are creative power. God saved us and he lives in our spirit. And now our soul is creative power that can possess the power of God. When our souls are lifted up, the creative power of our soul causes us to possess the power of God. We are in possession. Come here, James. Come here, Adrian. We are in possession. We're in possession. James, stand right there. It's my spirit. We're in possession. The spirit of God in your soul is in possession. Your soul is in possession of the power that God has. Now, y'all don't hear me. Y'all don't hear me. Your soul is in possession, has available the power of God.
Amen.
Jesus was connected to God. Jesus' soul was in possession of the power of God. That's why Jesus said, my will is just to do. My will is to do the work of the one that sent me. My food is to do the will of the one that sent me. Whatever God's will was, Jesus said, that's what my food is.
Amen.
That's what I eat. I'm just here to do the will of the one. So the desires that's in your heart, the plan that's in your heart, I'm telling you, man, this is going to make you just run up out this building. The desire in your heart for your family, for your children, for your spouse, for your loved ones, for your finances, the desire, the godly desires in your heart. Once you possess the power of God, you can see the manifestation of those things come true. I'm excited about it. I'm kind of mad at myself about it as well. But you ain't got to be mad or excited. You just got to know that the power of God, I can possess the power of God. I am supposed to possess the power of God in my soul. The renewing of my mind is not designed just so that I'll know who God is, so that I'll know what he's done. Praise God for Abraham and all them brothers in the old covenant and how the old covenant conceals and the new covenant reveals. Praise God for all of that. But what's the use of knowing that stuff if you ain't going to possess the power? What's the use of being able to explain who begot who and who begot this and this, that, and the other? What's the use of being able to talk about that if you have no power? If you possess no authority, if you walk not in the authority and the power, if the devil don't know you when he walk in the room, if the devil don't know your name, if the devil don't know you stand for something, if the devil don't know that you know who you are, then you ain't possessing the power. But when he know, when he know, you ain't hardly got to ask him to leave. It's some people that know you now. That see you walk in, they turn the other way. Because they know what you stand for. And it don't have to be good. It can be something in your past. They remembered you. They had an encounter with you or whatever. And they see you in a supermarket and you coming down the aisle. You don't see them. And they turn their buddy and go the other way. Because they say, I don't want to bump into her. I don't want to bump into him. I don't want to have a conversation with her because I know what she's about. Your soul, our soul, is to possess. Our soul is creative power. Creative power. Your soul, listen, God said, I can't do nothing down there without you. I can't do nothing. Although I possess all this power, I can do nothing to help. I can do nothing to heal. I can do nothing to deliver without you. Unless you possess in your soul, in your mind, in your heart, the power that I have, and then you're able to create based on the desires that you have in your heart, and the desires that you have in your heart lines up with my word. I said you can do it, but you can't do it until you possess the power. You can't do it until you see yourself as Christ saw himself. Some of us feel like, well, based on my performance, I can't see myself like Jesus saw himself. Based on my performance, based on how I live, based on what I've done, and based on what I'm doing, I cannot see myself. And that's where the devil defeats us. God is never asking you to see yourself. He's asking you to see Jesus. There's nothing God is saying that he wants. God don't want nobody to be like you. He wants all of us to be like Jesus. He don't want us to be like Paul, Peter, or John. He wants us to be like Jesus. Peter denied. Thomas was doubtful. He ain't saying be like any of the disciples. He says, see yourself like Jesus. See yourself like Christ. Christ in your spirit. Christ in your soul. Christ in your body. All the areas made holy. All the areas elevated. The desires that you have in your heart. The plans and the stuff that you know. It's some stuff we know we ought to be able to do. It's some stuff that we know we ought to see manifest. It's some stuff that you know ought to be happening right now, not happening. And because it's not happening, we get all satisfied and we just say, well, you know, it ain't happening. We start putting it off on other stuff. It ain't happening because we haven't possessed. We haven't elevated ourselves. We haven't taken our soul and elevated it up high enough. The reason we haven't, because over here where the body is, come here. Over here where the body is, we so concerned with the body. With the body. The appetite of the body. Amen? I'm concerned with what this body wants, what this body desires. How this body feels. I don't feel like it. We're concerned about the body. Kermit ain't going to be up here long. Because we ain't going to talk about the body. We're going to talk about the soul. Because wherever the soul goes, the body goes. Whatever the soul thinks, the body follows. Whatever's in the emotions and the feelings, if the feelings and the emotions are taken over by the spirit, then guess what? The body's going to line up. The body really ain't nothing to talk about. Go ahead, sir. The body really ain't nothing to talk about. It's the spirit and it's the soul. Because you are in custody. Say custody. You are, and you know what custody means. If the police arrest you, you're in custody of the police. They tell you when to eat. They tell you when to drink. They tell you what to do and this and that. Because you're in custody. You and me are in custody of our own soul. You tell your soul what to do. You tell your soul when to do it. You're in custody of it. God is not in custody of it, but God, we want him to be in custody of it. We want to give custody of our soul over to God. We want to say, God, just take it. But God will not take custody of your soul until you are physically dead. So while you are physically alive and spiritually alive, you are in custody of your own soul. Which means it's you seeing yourself. You taking yourself and you saying, Lord, bind me to Jesus. Bind me to Jesus. What Jesus has done, I can do. What Jesus has accomplished, I'm going to accomplish. It's not just not going to heaven and not going to hell. It's the work of Jesus. It's the work of the kingdom here right now. Amen. It's healing. It's delivering. It's setting free. It's praying. Amen. Jesus prayed for the centurion. Amen. He wasn't even there. He prayed and his spirit and his prayer went to where that sick person was and healed. We are no different.
Amen.
We ain't got to be jumping no car and rush over nowhere. We have the power.
Amen.
Possess power of God. Creative power that's on the inside of us. We've been created in the image and the likeness of God to be able to do everything that God has purposed us to do. Oh, we ought to feel bad when we ain't doing it. We ought to feel like there's something wrong. If I can't cast a demon out, if I can't deliver somebody that's sick, where you gonna go if I can't do it? Who's gonna do it if you can't do it? Who gonna heal the sick if you can't do it? Who gonna pray for them if you can't pray for them? You ought to be like, bring them here. Bring them to me. Bring them over here to abounding grace. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Come to abounding grace. We're going to get you healed. We're going to get you delivered. We're going to get you set free. I'm going to say it again. We're going to get you healed. We're going to get you delivered. And we're going to get you set free. And we're not going to do it because of our music department. We're not going to do it because of our preaching department. Because of no work in it. We're going to do it because we are possession. The creative power in our soul. And those and our desire for that person or person to be healed or delivered is going to come forward. Amen. See, we've been having the desire, but we haven't been possessing the power. We've been having the desire, but we have not elevated ourselves. It's hard sometimes to see yourself like Christ because you look at your own performance. And your own performance disqualifies you. But it's not our performance that got us here in the first place. It's our performance that got Jesus on the scene.
Amen.
Well, Pastor, you got to live. Listen, you go somewhere else. Listen, the only reason you gotta is because of Jesus. Jesus is the only one we need to look at. Amen. Well, don't you have to, listen, you have to trust Jesus. You have to trust, everybody can't do this. Everybody can't believe this way. You can, but you won't. You gotta see yourself. The same level as Jesus. Man, like four claps over here, three over here. Amen. Go to my next person. Amen. It says this. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry? Have a seat, brother. I'm not going to let y'all stand. Let me give that thing. And the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry to me? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. God said to them, he said, why all your crying.
Amen.
Go ahead, next verse up there. But lift up your rod. God said, lift up your rod and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. Now this is what God's saying. Here Moses is at the edge of the Red Sea. God had given him power. He had seen all miraculous things take place in this staff that he had. God was with him. He was with him. But now all of a sudden he gets to the edge of the Red Sea. And the people are behind him, and they're complaining, and Pharaoh's army is behind them. And Moses gets to this Red Sea and begins to cry. He begins to cry. And God is saying, why are you crying? He says, get up on your feet and stretch forth that rod. And God is saying the same thing to us. Why are you crying to me? What Moses simply did was possess the power that God had already placed in him and given him, placed with him. He took and he expected nothing initially. But when God spoke to him, he took that rod and he stretched it forward. And the Red Sea opened up. And the people went over on dry land. Did he do it? Y'all believe he did it? The same God that told Moses that is the same God that wants us to possess the power. See, Moses had a rod. And Jesus is a rod for us. He's a rod from the lineage of Jesse. And he has come and he lives on the inside of us. So we don't have to cry and we don't have to cry out to God and wonder if it's God's plan. God told them that he was going to deliver them out of Egypt. So they should have known that they were either going to walk on water or walk through the water. Doesn't matter how God do it. Listen, we just got to know that God is going to do it. Amen. 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 Listen, we got to know that God doing a little prayer thing and this and that. What's the use of praying? We ain't got no power.
Amen.
use of coming out here for if we're not going to have power? You know, all the technology and stuff we got today, we can do this on the phone. We can do this. We can Skype church. We can Skype services. We can, you know, what's the use of us even getting up coming here? We can sing you some songs that you can play on your phone, and we can do a pre-recorded message and stay at the house. What's the use? We are the believers who are supposed to have power. We can't let people that don't have power pull us down. Lukewarm Christians who come to church every now and then ain't got no word on your side of them. Pull you down. It's more of them than it are the ones that got some on the side of them. So you kind of outnumbered already. But you can't let them pull you down. We are supposed to see the manifestation of God. And our soul is supposed to line up with our spirit.
Yes, it is.
And at the end of the day, the power of God in your hands. James said, lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. He said, anoint them with oil. Because oil is representative of healing. That oil is a representative of something being crushed. You squeeze an olive fruit, you get olive juice. If you squeeze it, you get juice. If you crush it, you get oil. You can't squeeze it and get oil. It can only be crushed. Can get oil. So Jesus was crushed. He wasn't squeezed. You squeeze an olive fruit, you get olive juice. But if you crush it, you get olive oil. And so the crushing is symbolic of the disease and the sickness being crushed. The laying on of hand is the contact from God to that person. And the faith that you have in your heart, because you are possessing the power of God, is the indication, is the belief, is the knowledge. I know before I even touch this person, they're going to be healed. I don't know why I lost that. I always believed that. But you can get so locked into teaching of stuff and you know, taking people down the path that you forget what your assignment is. Now I'm chastising myself. I don't need nobody to do it for me. I do it myself. You forget the work of the kingdom. Demons have not got to the place where they're not scared of a real believer, of a person. They're not scared of God. They always tremble in the presence of God. God, I tell you. Praise God. Praise God. God said, you ready to go? You ready to go a little further?
Amen.
Your soul. Has got to possess the power of God in order for the miraculous to happen, in order for the desires of your heart to go forward. Your soul has got to possess the power of God. Amen. So Moses lifted up the rod because God had already spoken. We don't have to wonder if God wants somebody healed, God wants somebody delivered, God wants somebody set free. It's already spoken. The question is, do you believe it? Do you believe it enough? Do you believe it enough? Everybody preaching something good. Everybody teaching something good. You go to any church in this city, you can find a church where the preaching is good, off the chain. Where the word of God is coming forward. Many churches are preaching a powerful, anointed word. But ain't a lot of us.
Amen.
And I ain't even putting up Emmanuel on that plate yet. Where the power of God is being demonstrated. There's not a lot of churches where people get healed.
Amen.
Where people being delivered, where people being set free. Blind eyes being opened. You mean to tell me Jesus don't open blind eyes no more? When the last time you heard somebody blind eyes being opened? When you stop doing that? When you stop healing people? When you stop delivering people?
Jesus said, I never stop doing it. I'm the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He said, I changed up. He said, I didn't stop doing it. Y'all stop doing it. Y'all stop doing it. I didn't stop doing it. Y'all stopped it. He said, my disciples were still doing it when I left. Paul came along a little later. He was still doing it. He said, so it has nothing to do with me just being here. He said, I resurrected and was seated at the right hand of the Father. They were still doing it. It's not that I stopped doing it. Y'all stop. We stop. We traded it for buildings and all the other stuff we got going on. We traded it for, you know, different things. It's the same. It's the same. If your baby gets sick and the doctors can't help them, where are you going to take them? If they give up on your baby and say, there's nothing we can do, what you going to do? Who you gonna go to? Back in the 1800s, people would get that bad report and they would load their children up and run them to John Lake. Or they would run them to Smith Wigglesworth. They would find a meeting that they were running and they would try to get them. Even Oral Roberts, they would run them all the way to Oral Roberts. Camp meeting. Travel from California to Oklahoma to get a child there to be healed. Where you going to go now? What we say now is, the Lord give it. The Lord take it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. That's what we say now because God said, no, 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 no. No, I didn't take that. I didn't do that. Don't put that on me. I'm the Lord that healeth me. Because you don't have the power, God, so don't put it on me. Amen. Disciples had the little boy at the bottom of the mountain. They couldn't heal him. His dad had brought him. They was throwing himself in fire, sometimes drowning himself. And then the disciples couldn't do it. And so the man waited on Jesus. And Jesus came down from the Mount of Transfiguration. Him and three of his other disciples. And the man took his son to Jesus and said, I took my son to your disciples. They couldn't help him. And, you know, I'm wondering if you can. And Jesus, and the man said, I don't have a lot of faith. And Jesus said, give him to me. And Jesus healed the boy. Well, later on, that evening, the disciples pulled Jesus to the side and said, Master, why could we not do this? He didn't say, well, you know, because I'm the Son of God. I can do all the miraculous things. He didn't say, oh, because I'm the Son of God, there's some things that you just won't be able to do. He said to them, because of your unbelief. He said, because of your unbelief.
Right.
That's why you couldn't do it. So when you pray for somebody again and they don't get healed and you say, why, Lord, why did it happen? Say, because of my unbelief. He didn't say because of the man's unbelief or the little boy's unbelief. He said because of your unbelief. Because when you're praying, you're the one to have faith. It's your faith. It's the prayer. It's your faith. It's the fervent prayer of the righteous that availeth much. And it didn't happen because at that moment they didn't possess the power. They didn't know who they were. They didn't walk. They didn't say, well, man, we are children of the living God. We are able to do this. We've been given authority in the name of Jesus. Power by way of the Holy Spirit. And we should be able to do this because Jesus had given them both. He had given them authority and power.
That's right.
He said, y'all go out and y'all heal the sick. You cast out demons. And they came back and they gave a good report. 70 of them went out at one time. And they came back and they said, them devils were subject to us. We tell them to go and they would go. And they did because they possessed what Jesus had said. They possessed the power. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. Here it is in Jesus. He's showing us how to do it. He's showing us. He says, I am the resurrection and life. And we are because we have grown from his resurrection. Because of his resurrection, and we know the power of the resurrection. I know, you know, we know the power. You got to know the power of his resurrection. The power of his resurrection. Jesus got up. The Holy Spirit came down as a receipt. You know, like when you buy something, you get a receipt. You get a receipt.
that it was purchased, we never would have known that Jesus had made it to be seated at the right hand of God had not the Holy Spirit come down. The Holy Spirit came down, that was our receipt. He came down as a receipt that Jesus had made it, and that Jesus was seated. See, the other folk thought Jesus had just died. But when Peter preached on the day of Pentecost and the Holy Spirit came down, receipt. Amen. That's our receipt. The Holy Spirit is a receipt that Jesus is alive. That Jesus is seated at the right hand of God. Amen. When they said, how did y'all heal this man? How did you get this man up and walk? He said, Peter said, that Jesus, in the name of Jesus, the one that you killed, the one that you crucified, it is in his name that this man has gotten up and walked. The stone that you rejected, it is in his name that he is walking today. It's not by any power that we have, but it's by the power of Jesus Christ that we possess. Amen. We possess that power. We possess the power. In the name of Jesus. Can't help other people don't understand it. You got to understand it. You got to receive it. You got to walk in it. Amen. In your spirit, in your soul, in your body, you got to walk in it. In your body, you at the store. Somebody need prayer, so lay your hands on it and believe God. Believe God. What your body's saying, people watching you, let them watch. Let them listen. You ain't got to whisper. You ain't got to be quiet. You ought to want them to whisper. You ought to want them to hear what's going on. Hallelujah. It's not in my name I'm doing it. It's in the name of Jesus. I'm possessing the power. My soul is lifted up. Say, my soul is lifted up. Gotta lift your soul up higher, higher. Our soul has been down in the gutter too long. I can't do it. What's going to happen? Our soul has been down. We got to lift our soul up. Lift our, elevate our soul up where Jesus is. Gotta elevate it up. Lift your soul up there. So your thoughts, your mind will be like his. Now when he said these things, he cried with a loud voice. Jesus prayed. After he prayed, that's what we do when we pray. Jesus prayed. He's in humanity. He's standing in front of Lazarus' tomb. After he prayed, then he said, Lazarus, come forth. Because he got authority. You got authority. You got authority. You got authority. Amen. You got authority to speak. You got an authority given to you by God. Amen. Because you're in connection. You're bound to Jesus. You're filled in your spirit. You're filled in your soul. You're filled in your body. And because I'm filled with Jesus in every part of me, I'm sanctified holy in every part of me. It's not just enough for me to know how the spirit works, the soul works, and the body works. If I'm not manifesting, if I'm not lined up with Jesus, I'm lined up with Jesus. I'm not sub to Jesus. It says we're joint heirs. We're joint. We're right here. You're not down here. You're right here with Jesus. The Bible said Jesus, who didn't think it was a problem to see himself equal with God. Jesus saw himself equal with God.
Amen.
He didn't make himself nothing big, but he said, I'm equal with God. I'm bound to God, and we are bound to Jesus. In our spirit, in our soul, in our body. Amen. And so the desires in your heart, they're there because God put them there. He says, you can heal her. He says, you can deliver her. He says, you can turn that around. He says it. That's why you got that thing in your heart. That's why you hear that in your spirit. I should be able to do something about this. And then the devil began to take you to your performance. Well, you know, you've been living right. Well, you know, you cussed yesterday. You know, you conned somebody yesterday. You cheated. You did this. He began to take you to your performance. Cast it down. Your performance has nothing to do with the work of the kingdom. It's not your performance. It's Jesus' performance. What you're doing is not in your name. It's in his name. You have no access in your name. But in the name of Jesus, you got access. In the name of Jesus, every knee.
Every knee.
bows. Every tongue confess. In your name, nothing happens. You ever went to someone, use somebody else's name? Because you know your name meant nothing. You ever got access because of somebody else's name? You name drop, you say, you know, such and such sent me. And they open the door and you walk right in. It ain't got nothing to do with you. They might not even like you, but the name. The name. The name. The name. And when you use that name, because you know you have the right to use it. You got the right to use that name. I ain't just name dropping. I got a right to use this name. When I use this name, I got a right. I got a right to it. It's been given to me. Ask anything in my name and I'll do it. When Jesus said, ask anything in my name, he said, I'll do it. So when you ask it a lot in his name, but sometimes we ask amiss, we ask not expecting anything. But when we ask expecting something, when we ask knowing that the name I'm about to drop this name is about to, I'm about to drop this name, about to test something up in here. I'm going to drop this name. I already said to heal. But when I call this name, oh, something about to happen. Be healed. See, be healed mean nothing. Be healed don't mean nothing. Anybody can say be healed. But when you say in the name of Jesus, when you say in the name of Jesus behind it, you can say be healed, but it's not until you say in the name of Jesus. And you say it because you're expecting every demon to fall down. When you say, I'm about to drop a name on you here. I don't tell you what I want, but everything I don't pray for, I don't pray for. But when I say this name, it's about to open the door. It's about to cut some heads off. It's about to dispatch legions of angels. When I say this name, it's about to release some angels on the scene. The angels at the edge of heaven, let them come in. When I say this name, the angels sitting there. The God holding the mercy. Y'all wait. Just wait. He ain't said the name yet. Examine your mouth. He examine your heart. He look at your heart. Do she know what she's saying? Do he know what they're saying? But you don't say it loud. You don't say it loud. You say it dignified because you know you have a right to use it. You ain't sweating. You just say in the name of Jesus. And boy, Michael and them angels come down and they destroy the plan of the devil. They destroy the work of Satan. Heal bodies, they deliver, they come all around you. As soon as you say that name,
yes, Lord.
But you gotta know that when I say, I don't play with this name. I don't just call it like everybody do. When I say this name, I'm expecting something to happen. Not expecting, I know something gonna happen. I'm about to call this name. I'm in this meeting about to call his name. These people on me in this meeting, I'm about to call his name. When I call his name, he's going to turn the whole meeting around. Because my soul is in possession of the power of God. And it's creative power that takes my desires, the desires of my heart. The creative power. God say, Brian, I can't heal this person. Come here, bro, and kneel down right here. Say, Brian, I can't heal this person.
Yeah.
I can't heal this person. I can heal him, but I can't do it unless I do it through you. I can't do it unless you believe. The Holy Spirit can't just come in and do it on his own. God put himself out of business with that when he said, and let them have dominion. he said, now I need a host. I need a body where my spirit can live in. That's why the Bible said, don't you know your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? He says, I need a spirit where I can live in. And this man comes sick and he comes diseased and he comes broken. And you pray, oh God, heal him. And God said, I want to. It's in my word, I want to.
Yes.
But you got to go over there and do something.
Yes, yes.
You got to lay hands.
Yes, yes.
You're in possession of my power. So now when you lay hands, it flows
Hallelujah.
Through you.
Amen.
And heals him.
Hallelujah.
And you're not surprised. We've been too surprised as believers. God say, you think surprising is a good thing? God, it's being surprised is not good for believers.
My God.
Me and Pescoy shared reading Smith Wigglesworth, one of the greatest generals of God's of our time. And Smith would walk around and he would lay hands on people. They would be almost dead. He would just walk and touch them. Punch him, hit him or something. And he'd keep on moving down the line. And this man would get up and Smith would never look back. He'd just keep on going to the next one. He knew that when he touched him, he was getting up. He touched the man on the journey and the man died. The man doctor was there with him and the man died. He stopped breathing and the doctor stood up and said, you killed him. Smith never looked back. He kept laying hands, kept doing things. The man got up off that journey and ran down the aisle. So we ought not be surprised. We ought not be surprised. We ought not be sitting waiting in anticipation. I said, God gonna do something. When we pray, we don't pray thinking, well, maybe God don't want to do it. God always, He said, I'm gonna write my word ahead of time. I'm gonna write it ahead of time. So you won't never have to question, is this something I want to do? It's I want to heal. I heal all men. And you will never have to question, is it something you have the power to do?
That's right.
Mark, he said, I give you power to lay hands on the sick.
Yes.
And they shall recover to cast out demons.
Yes.
Amen. And the disciples came back with a report. We did it and it happened.
Yes.
They weren't surprised. They had an expectation.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Come on, we got to have an expectation.
Yes.
Because I am he who was lived and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. How is he alive forevermore? Amen. And I have the keys of hell and death. He said, I got the keys of hell and death. He lives in us. He lives in us, leaders. He lives in us. Ministers, facilitators, he lives in us. Believers, he lives in us. He has the keys to hell and death. Amen. And he lives in us.
Yes.
So I'm going to get these keys. When I come back, I'm going to get Jesus' body up out of this tomb. It was Christ that did that. He got the keys. Jesus dies on the cross. Christ goes to hell. He get the keys of hell and death. So that now death don't have dominion over you. Hell don't have dominion over us. You ain't got to go to hell. You bypass hell. Praise God.
Praise God. Glory.
Ain't nobody in here that's saved going to hell. You already know. If you believe in Jesus, you already know going through your first judgment. Jesus was your judgment on the cross. You ain't got to stand in no judgment line like the lost. Because your judgment has already been paid for. Brother Brian, what about my sin that I committed last night? Is it paid for too?
Yes, it is.
He died for past, present, and future.
Amen.
But Jesus said, it is finished. That's what he meant. It's finished.
Amen.
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 I don't know about you, but when I finish stuff at home, I go somewhere and sit down. That's what Jesus did. He said, it's finished, and he went somewhere and sat down. And then he said, I've given you to be seated with me in heavenly places. So he says, well, you can sit down too. Because it's finished. It's finished. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. And why did he do that? For the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. What does that mean? That means this is the body of Christ. And every day we're edifying it. Every day we're becoming perfect. Perfect. This man is becoming perfect. God is making you to be perfect. Because as you, listen, as you receive, as your soul is elevated, you're becoming perfect. Perfect in every way. Your soul, because you're in possession of the power of God. And what Jesus did, you're doing. What Jesus has said, you're able to do it. Perfect. Amen? Amen. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of what?
Fullness.
Who are we talking about? Talking to us. Yes. Talking to you. Talking to me. Yes. The fullness of Christ. Glory, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Last one. This is my last one. Amen. Praise God. Matthew 7:16. You will know them. People gonna know us. They're gonna know us by our fruit. Huh? The body, the church, the assembly is not a place just to be inspired. Oh, I was so inspired today. What is inspiration then? What is inspiration? This church is not a place for inspiration, but a place for demonstration.
Yes.
A place to see the demonstration of God's power. Yes. Paul said, I didn't come to you with persuasive and elegant words. I didn't come to you sounding all uppity and this and that. But he said, with the power, with demonstration.
All right.
That's what he came with.
That's right.
People being healed, people being delivered. People being set free. Disciple being able to touch a handkerchief, anoint a handkerchief, and it healed people. Disciple being able to, so connected to God. God, man, this is, there's nothing new under the sun. There's nothing that can't happen today that happened then. The disciple so anointed that he walked past people in the street and his shadow falling off and healing them. The power of God upon us. That means his mind was on God, whether he was in church or on his way home from church. That he was in, that Christ was in and out of him. In and out. And Christ wants to be in and out of us. That when you walk past people, your mind, you're walking past people that are sick, you say, I ain't got time to touch all of the Lord, heal them. In the hospital, walking down the halls of the Lord, heal these people, roam and passing. And you're expecting him to do it. Because you know, you say, man, I'm the express image. Do y'all understand what I say when I say, I'm the express image of the invisible God? I'm the express image of Jesus Christ, who said, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. What Paul said, so Christ is in me. I am the express image of him. He's invisible. God is invisible. He's a spirit. Jesus is in a spirit. He's seated in heaven now. In humanity, he's a man in heaven. But his spirit is in us.
Yes.
And so that spirit is in us, that's in us, causes us to be the expressed image. This is what you see.
Amen.
From the God that's living on the inside of me. This is what you see when I lay hands. This is what you see when I speak. So we are all the expressed image of the invisible God. Who lives on the inside of us.
Yes.
And people are going to know you.
Glory.
And know me.
Glory.
By our fruit.
Amen.
Now we think that we carrying our Bible and coming to Sunday school and coming to Bible study and being able to pray and all that stuff. No, but people are seeing that kind of fruit everywhere.
Amen.
That fruit growing on all kinds of trees. People need to see the power of God. That's in you, that's in me, that's in the desires of our heart. God speaking to our heart saying, you can do it. You should be able to do it. And then our hearts were saying, why am I not doing it? God put it in your heart. Heal this person. Deliver this person. Set this person free. That's in your heart. You know. You know that it's supposed to be happening today. But it's not happening today. It's not because of Jesus. Hallelujah. Let us stand. George, give me my cue back there. If you come back to me, I'll still use you. You denied me, and you're the one that's going to get all the credit on preaching on Mount Zion, and the Holy Spirit come down, and you're the one that denied me. Jesus said, I'll just do foolish stuff that the world cannot even understand. Other disciples could have used James, could have used John. He could have used them, right? But he didn't. He used Peter. And he'll use you. He'll use me. Peter didn't continue to deny him, did he? No, he didn't continue to do that. So we ain't got to continue to do what we've been doing. We just got to now. Now say, today, Lord, I'm elevating my soul. I'm elevating my soul. Can you put my title back up, please? I'm elevating my soul. I'm elevating my soul to possess the power of God. Power through the soul of man. That's what it is. Power through the soul of man. Come on, lift your hands to the Lord. Say, Lord, I lift my soul up to you. Lift my soul to you, God. Hallelujah. Lord, God, we lift our souls to you. And Father, we pray that you would open up our soul and open up your spirit and allow your spirit, dear God, let your spirit be connected to our soul, man, Lord, to our mind, to our way, dear God, and that we will possess the power. Possess your power, God. That the desires of our heart would manifest from the possession and the creative power that's being created in us to see the manifestation of what we pray and what we believe. That when we stand praying, Lord, that we will stand in full confidence and full assurance that what we are speaking and what we are saying, that we have the authority and the power to say it, oh God. And that the manifestation will come when we speak the name of Jesus. God, we thank you for renewing our spirit and renewing our mind. We thank you, Lord, that we will not be the same, God. We choose not to be the same. We choose that our souls are not in the miry clay, but that our souls are elevated to you, Lord. And that Jesus is in our spirit, in our soul, and in our body. That our minds are renewed and transformed every day. And that we stand, oh God, as ambassadors for those who are sick and diseased and broken, those who are in trouble, God, that we stand, God, stand firm, Lord, in their presence, knowing, dear God, that we are in contact with you, that we are possessing you, and that when we lay our hands and make contact with them, that they are making contact with you. And that when we anoint them, that they are anointed, God. That every stronghold and every band of wickedness is broken, God, in the name of Jesus. That the devil flees. Even the sound of our name calls him to know that we are in possession of your power. And that we have the authority, even before we speak, that he will tremble and fall and be cast down, cast out into dry places.
God, we thank you. God, I lift up our sister Ashley Ford this morning. Hallelujah. God, I bind in the name of Jesus. God, I'm possessing your power. Every attack on her mind, everything that the devil has done, everything that demonic spirits and unclean spirits have done to her, God, I command them to go in the name of Jesus. I command her brain to be restored and her mind to be restored. In the name of Jesus, Satan, you cannot have her. You will not have her. We defeat you in the name of Jesus. You've been here too long, and you're not coming back. In Jesus' name, bless her husband, Lord. Bless her family, God. We bind every attack on that family, Lord. Every attack on that family, God, in the name of Jesus, on that husband and on those children, God, we bind you, Satan. We arrest you in the name of Jesus, and we cast you into dry places. Go and return no more in the name of Jesus. God, build walls around that family. Send angels, God. We dispatch angels in the name of Jesus. Hedge that family in, God. Strengthen them in your word, oh God. In the name of Jesus. God, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, that it's not too late. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Whatever you need to say, but I need you to say at this time, And I need you to, when you say it, before you even say it, before you even pray it, you got to believe that you have received. He said, when you stand praying, believe that you receive, and you shall have what you say. So at this very moment when you ask God something, you got to believe it even before you ask Him. And you got to believe that you receive. And it's at that moment that you'll have. So whatever it is you're asking for, you got to believe that you receive.
Hallelujah.
And say, you shall have. So go ahead and as you pray to have your seat, as you pray and ask God for what you need, for believing you receive, and then you have it. Don't doubt it. In the name of Jesus. Keep our souls lifted up. In Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen. Let us prepare our hearts for the ministry of giving. Amen. Jesus is about to fix it.
Yeah.
When you look at that cup, say, thank you, Jesus. For your blood. All my sins. Every one of them. Under the blood of Jesus. Now look, who could love them? A Savior like that. Who could love Jesus? You think about everything you've done under this blood? Woo! And they ate and drank together. Thank you.
hearts.